So hello everyone, and it's a great pleasure to see a full house, and we're going to talk about our city, Bengaluru, and this is Meera's lovely book which was just released about 10 days ago. And I think it's doing really brisk business already. So this is a book which is a labor of love, and I think has been at least 5 years in the making, if not more.
Well, there are some portions of it which were written about 10 years ago, but most of it, over the last 5 years. Yeah.
So it's something that we've heard of, and in fact, I have a chapter with another colleague on Sampangi Lake in the book. But I know the kind of effort that's gone into this book for a long time, and I hope many of you go and... How many of you have a copy of the book? Ah, that's a lot already. So for those of you who don't, please go and check them out. There are lots of books there, and I'm sure Meera will be happy to sign. Before we begin, I just thought I'll do a quick show of hands. How many of you are old Bangaloreans? However you want to define yourself. Self-defined. Self-defined. How many of you are new to the city? Okay, the book has something new, I'm sure, for you. Those of you who think you're old Bangaloreans and know the city really well, and for those of you who are new and want to discover the city. Certainly, I myself, and I've been working on Bangalore for a long time, and I'm definitely an old Bangalorean, found so much new to read about in the book. So I was just wondering if maybe we could begin, Meera, with a little bit of background. If you could just tell them a little bit about the book and why you started writing it. There are a lot of books on Bangalore, so I know many of you have a question of, do we need another book on the city? What difference does this make, and how does this shine a different light on the city?
So you're right, there are a number of really excellent books about the city already, but I think we felt that there was place for a different one, which talks more about the city, especially from the point of view of what you can see, feel, experience yourself. So, and we were also very clear that we wanted a book that was not too academic and was, but was also accessible. Authentic, academic, but also accessible. So, and also, as you can see, this the book is really a history of the neighborhoods of the city, some of the older neighborhoods. And we felt it was important for this. So every chapter has a brief history of the neighborhood itself, followed by one or two walks through the city. And we felt this was really important because we want people to go out and experience the city for themselves. It's one thing to read about it, but it's another to actually walk around the city, feel and experience it yourself, talk to people, because that's how you really get to know your city and feel something for it. So that's why.
I think that's fascinating, because if you look at, I mean, what I was very struck by in the book is the way in which it's been planned as a complete thing. And that, I think, is the heritage point of view, also the artistic thinking that's gone into the book, quite apart from the history and the research. Because you can see, I mean, just to give you a sense, every page has a nice photograph, a map, something visual. So you feel like you're walking in the city. Every chapter has a sort of a trail through the city and things. So I'm just curious, was that planned? And
yeah, so I think this is really partly a result of my background, which is in academics. I have a PhD, as you know. And it's also because for the last 10 or 12 years, I've been working, volunteering with INTAC, the International Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, where I'm surrounded by architects who have very visual ways of thinking. Right. So I think it's really a mix of those two that has resulted in the way it looks. Yeah.
So what are the neighborhoods that you've covered?
So there's the Pete, the Kote, the old parts of the city, the so-called native parts of the city. There's Basavangudi, Malleshwaram. And actually, we've had a lot of people saying, I'm so glad you covered these two neighborhoods somehow. Frasertown and some of the other parts of the cantonment. There's also Whitefield, Sampangi Ramnagar, which you and Hitta have written about. And there's also Lalbagh, because we felt that it was important to include both a component of lakes and gardens, because really, what is Bangalore without these two? So right. we were quite definite from the beginning that there would be these two components as well.
So quick quiz, for those of you who don't know, Sampangi Ramnagar, which was a lake, is now what? Kantirva Stadium, yeah, exactly. So as Meera's saying, when you walk around and talk to the people, when Hitta, who was a PhD student of mine, who did a chapter on Sampangi Lake, and that's the chapter in the book, really, of her thesis. So when we walked around that place, we found, so there's a temple with the priest's house, and in the garden, there is just the remnant of the structure, which was an 18-pulley system for pulling out water from the well. The well is no longer there, but you can imagine the size of the well that must have been there if you had an 18 pulleys that were there along with this. There is a tank which is now being used as a community center where they have yoga and they do Shivratri with lamps and things like that. Interestingly, the tank used to have water, but they filled it because they said if there's water, it's stagnant and it's dirty. So they wanted to keep it clean by removing the water. So you can see how, you know, ideas have changed. We went to a place which is called Sampangi Ramnagara Kalyani Slum. It used to have a Kalyani. It's now been filled up. And there's a cattle grazing community which says they've been there for a long time. Mm-hmm. But they say that they still get a lot of money out of cattle, but they want to move away from the profession because it's now disrespected in the city and their sons can't find brides because cattle rearing is no longer a profession to aspire to. And so you see, when you go out, I think I really see your point of going out with this book, doing the trails, walking and talking to people and understanding how their lives have changed and how they perceive this heritage. Each of us has our own story and our own connection with heritage, and that to me is the real complexity of this. So actually, when I pick up on that, I'm very curious. Meera, for those of you who don't know, has a PhD in ecology and a very different sort of previous, I think, professional life, and now does something very different. But I'm sure there are transitions because, again, if you look, read at the Lal Bagh chapter, for instance, or many of the other chapters, you can see really for you if heritage is not just buildings, it's not just in the environment. It is a lived heritage which encompasses people's perceptions of all of these, but also the built component and the natural component. So I was wondering if you could tell us, how do you think that journey of being, you know, doing something else and moving to this has shaped the way in which this particular book is written?
Well, for one thing, yes, I was an ecologist, and ecology is still very close to my heart. But I don't see them, I don't see history, heritage, and ecology as being vastly different, because we're really talking about things. It's a different form of heritage, right? When you look at a forest, for example, it's a different kind of heritage, natural heritage. So it was just moving laterally, in a sense, in my head. But the other thing is, you're right, that I think the training and thinking in ecology has influenced my thinking about built heritage and thinking about the city, because one thing that's drilled about into you when you're working on ecology is the connectedness of all things, and that's something you see everywhere. So it's, as you said, it's not just the buildings, it's also the way people use them, live through them, live with them. It's also the intangible heritage that you see around all of this, and you see how each is shaped by the other. So yes, that is definitely a part of the way I look at things, and I hope it comes through in the book as well.
I'm just picking up on that point because I don't know how many, I'm sure many of you are aware about the recent protests in Cubbon Park about the building that's supposed to come up, 7-story building, and the loss of both the built heritage and the ecological heritage that that represents. And I think this is an important point because unfortunately in this city we have so much heritage, but we are so unaware of our heritage. And whether it's lakes, yeah, you can fill them over and you can create another lake somewhere or do something else somewhere, get water from the Kaveri. If it's trees, you can cut down 100-year-old trees, but you can plant 10 saplings for each tree, so it's fine, you know. That. Or if it's an old building, then you can, I mean, Krumbigal's building fell down in Lal Bagh, but now they can create a replica where you couldn't conserve the building. So I think this is a sense that we need to recreate this,
so,
right?
So I think this is a problem that is particularly, it's kind of unique, or maybe more so in Bangalore, because as was mentioned in the introduction, for various reasons, Bangalore has always been seen as a city without a past. So some years ago when Jawaharlal Nehru came, I think he said, oh, it's the city of the future. And any, almost any Bangalorean, when you speak to them, not almost any, but many Bangaloreans, when you speak to them, many people in Karnataka, when you ask them about heritage, it's their idea of a heritage city is Mysore. So people still don't know that there is plenty in Bangalore that we have still retained from the past. So this is a problem that we've had to surmount even at INTAC. From the time when we started our walks, like our heritage walks about 10, 11 years ago, it's always been said, you know, what is there in Bangalore? What is there in Bangalore? But so I think that is changing to a certain extent now, but not enough among government officials, I feel. So there's also not much... there's also, I think, needed a change in mindset, because people don't think of heritage as something that can actually add value to a city. Whereas you and I know that actually, when you walk through a city, when you have these old buildings, when you have remnants of the past, those are all, like, old buildings are actually memories, right? So it's so nice to actually have these familiar things around you, and they help you build a connect to the city. When you lose that, you feel a little unmoored, you know? You feel a little disoriented. And that's not good for anyone living in the city. So, but I think people don't recognize that. So this is one problem. The second thing is that there's also, especially among government officials, there's also a feeling that everyone wants some, you know, the patina of old is not appreciated, unfortunately. They want like spanking new chrome and glass and all. So we need to change that. We need to show them that we actually do care about our heritage, whether it is natural, like Kabban Park, or whether it is lakes, or whether it is buildings. They all add to the character of the city and to the lives of the people living in them. So a third problem that we have, especially working in the area of heritage, is that because it's not a life and death issue, nobody's going to die if you break down a heritage building. But it adds to the quality of life. It adds to your quality of living in the city. So maybe because it's not a life and death issue, it's not seen as a priority. So it's not seen as a priority as much. So, but these are all problems we've had to face, and obviously not just in tech. There are a lot of people working in this field of protecting heritage, and this is something we all face.
I think there are multiple parts of this that we need to fix. One part is the museums, for instance. There's so much more, you know, for instance, the Kempe Gowda Museum. I don't know how many of you have gone there. It was a beautiful museum. It could have been, you know, more attention or more money, I think funding could have been given to it, but now it's going to get it's moving to a different place, and it's not in the location that it was. It's not as accessible as it used to be. And the second is, how do you make this a living heritage? So you don't have to just go to a museum. I mean, for instance, what I think is really nice is the work that Intac and the group on Bangalore inscriptions. Uday is here somewhere? So there's a very interesting and alive group now working on looking at the stone inscriptions around Bangalore and recreating them as places of heritage within their area. So the very core focus is not to move them into a museum where you go and see them, but keep them as a living heritage so that community, that neighborhood knows that their neighborhood was 1,500 years old and this was the oldest resident that is recorded there. So I think, to me, again, the connection of this book with Intac's work and all the walks and the heritage walks that you're doing, do you see that when people come for these heritage walks, they get more connected? I mean, what happens after the walk? Then they go away, and then what?
So, okay, so the premise behind the book and a lot of the work that Intac does is if you know something, you understand it. If you understand it, you appreciate it. And if you appreciate it, you're willing to do something about it, right? So there are three links. So we will try in the first and the second and hope for the third. So, but I think it has happened among many people we've had a lot of people who have come on our walks who initially were really not all that aware about the heritage around the city. But having come on these walks, we've had people who've actually called back and said, you know, XYZ building is falling, so-and-so thing is being planned, you should do something about it. And then they themselves tell us that if it hadn't been for your walks, if it hadn't been for our introduction to the city's heritage through what you do, then I would never have thought about this. I would never have noticed it at all. So I think there is that change that is happening. Yeah.
To recreate an obsession with your past and a knowledge and a love of your city, it's very easy to tear down something. It takes a lot of time to build it. And so this is really that labor of love. And I think all of us need to get out into our city much more, walk around on the weekends, talk to the people that are there and rediscover our heritage. And actually from this, I'd like to come to one point, because there's many, many years ago, I think I met you first at least 11, 12 years ago. And soon after that, we worked on a very interesting piece of research on Lalbagh and on Tipu Sultan's contribution to Lalbagh, which is particularly topical today when we're trying to talk about how much we need to think about Tipu Sultan or what we need to think about Tipu Sultan. But Hyder and Ali and Tipu Sultan were undisputably, I think, the
creators of Lal Bagh, which is a, you know, one of the most important heritage spaces we have in Bangalore today. And we started with another colleague, Rajini, this very interesting piece of research. I'd like Meera to tell us a little bit about this, only because doing heritage research in an Indian city is very difficult. We might be the IT city, but we have zero documentation. Doing heritage work in the West is so much easier. And here it's really detective work, piecing together little pieces of the puzzle. So if you can just...
Thanks for bringing that up, Harini. So before I get into the Lal Bagh, so I should mention that the kinds of resources we've had to access for this book, it's literally around the world, because there would be calls sent out to people living in New York and people living in London. Anyone going to London that I knew would get an SOS, please, please go to the British Library and check out this file. Because as you said, we don't have many of the archives within our country, and most of it is actually abroad. It's also a little sad that the archives that we do have in the city are a little bit inaccessible because they're in the Vidhan Sauda, so it's like getting into a fortress. It's possible, but a little difficult. So a lot of people from around the world, especially from the US and UK and Australia, have actually helped in digging out some obscure journal or some reference from something or the other, and all of that has contributed to the book. Coming to the research on Lal Bagh, that was really, really fun. So Harini and I share this passion for old maps, and so like we were poring, or I was looking through these old maps, and then you notice these little... Outside the old fort of Bangalore in a 1792 map, we noticed these little markings that indicated what looked like gardens. And so I contacted Harini, and then we got in touch with Rajini, who also works with maps, and she's from the National Institute of Advanced Studies. So the three of us got together, and then we pored over these maps, and we figured out that this is probably an older, it's probably one of the early representations of Lal Bagh on a map. What was interesting was that it was actually not contiguous as we see it today. So we had to actually look at, like she said, it was a lot of detective work, because we had to look at old paintings, old maps, and then we also had to ground truth everything, walk around the place, talk, read a lot. And all of that culminated in this little paper that we had in Current Science some years ago, which indicated that Lal Bagh, as we know it today, was actually five separate gardens, which at some point have actually been combined into one. And the exact location of the garden as we see it today, or as we think of in the past today, is not what it was. It was actually a little bit further away from what most people think today. So anyway, that was like really interesting, the way we had to bring in these different lines of evidence to put this thing together.
So Rajini sat with two old paintings, one from the east side and one from the west side, and took topographic maps. And from these two paintings and the topography, created a three-dimensional view, which also told us that some of the Cypress Gardens were outside what we currently think of as Lal Bagh. Then we used the maps as another line of evidence. And then Meera dug out some archival work from an old book, which talked about one of the gardens being downstream from a lake and the other one being upstream from a lake, which also tells us, if you piece all of this together, that at least some of these gardens were outside what we think of as Lal Bagh today. So this is history that we've lost, and this is the kind of detective work, you know, it takes to put this together. So it's really, as you say, it's history is something that is so contested today. To get good history done in an atmosphere of incomplete information requires trying to triangulate multiple strands, and then to make that accessible to people, to the common man or woman, is something, and interesting. Not just accessible, but, you know, something fun, something that's not boring and dry, that tells you a series of dates and somebody X did this and Y did that. And so that, I think, to make that happen is really something which is very fascinating. So I'm at least very excited, and I hope a lot of us take this book along with us. I certainly plan to do this on trails with my daughter and take her into the city and start talking to people. And with that, shall we just
There was just one other thing I wanted to bring up, Harini, which is that one thing that when you do go out with the book, unfortunately, you will find that a lot of the heritage that we talk about in the city is behind locked doors. So we do have a few government-supported heritage areas, like the Bangalore Fort and the Palace. Even they close after 5. So unlike other cities in India, such as, say, Delhi, where heritage areas are actually public spaces, that is something we lack in the city. And I feel that's such a shame, because it as it is, the city lacks public spaces. Some of these heritage areas could actually lend themselves to becoming places where people congregate. Even our parks, for example, why do they close from 10 to 4? So, you know, many of the parks do have buildings in them. They do have a lot of natural heritage, but then they are inaccessible to people for most of the day. This is something that's really, really sad, and I wish that could be changed.
Absolutely, and that is something we really need to, I think, concertedly make efforts in terms, you know, it's not just that the parks are closed, but what you can do. For instance, if you want to go in with a camera and photograph a heritage building, then you immediately have a security guard coming in and saying, why are you taking this camera in? And, you know, these are things that when you want to do, when you want to get people engaged with the heritage of your city, I think you need to have much more support from all walks of citizenry and officialdom in Bangalore.
So, unfortunately, like, you're made to feel like public enemy number one when you go into any, you want to see a lovely government building? No, you cannot.
Right.
We're all like security threats.
Yes. So that is something, I think, which will only change if many of us storm the frontiers and keep doing this repeatedly.
Exactly.
And, the other thing we were just thinking of, Meera and I, before this, is that Bangalore is also, it's a very interesting cosmopolitan city because it's so neighborhood oriented. For instance, I identify myself as South Bangalorean, even though I live in Sarjapur for years now, and so does Meera. But, you know, so North Bangaloreans, then there's the Pete people, and then there's the cantonment people. So we hope you go with this into neighborhoods that you're not part of and go explore them, not just your own neighborhood. So we have some time for questions.
We have 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
I have a question for you. I've never heard of an intact walk. I've been on innumerable walks and talks about old Bangalore, and I'm a member of Intact. They send me emails. I've never heard of Intact Walk.
I think you need to check your spam folder because we do send out emails every month. We're also written about quite a bit in the media. Maybe we can talk later. I will make sure your email is added to a mailing list. Yeah.
Any other question?
They're very popular talks, so I mean walks. I know from personal experience that if you have not signed up in the next half an hour, you get an email saying, sorry, they booked.
Ma'am, so I live in the Baswangudi area, and I've been living there for like 12 years now. So what I wanted to ask you about is, what's your opinion on the houses getting reconstructed there? Because when I used to walk around in Baswangudi before, there were only old houses there. But now everyone's breaking those houses, and there are like, their buildings with like lot and apartment buildings that are there that can accommodate more people because the city requires more spaces to stay in, and that's the justification. But somewhere it just has killed what the area looked like before.
So there are two things about this. One is that we do need some kind of regulations in the city to protect heritage. Ideally, it would be really good if there would be regulations to protect both government buildings as well as private buildings. By that I mean, there should be some law, there should be some rules saying that you cannot break down heritage buildings. Now, this might not go down very well with owners of, you know, private property owners, and with good reason. Which is why, along with this, merely having a regulation or a law is not really going to help. What we also need is to have a fund set aside so that people who own heritage buildings can be helped in some way. You know, to restore their building, to maybe, I mean, property tax I know is a really small thing, but there could be various ways in which this fund could be used to help people who own heritage buildings. There could also be other ways of dealing with this problem of people saying they have heritage buildings and cannot maintain them. So, for example, maybe you could relax certain zoning regulations, if there are any, saying that if you have a property, a heritage property in a private area, in a residential area, you can commercialize it because that's one of the ways in which you can actually make money from heritage if you own an old building. Because all said and done, even though people are breaking down buildings, a lot of people actually appreciate having a coffee, for example, in an old building. So these are really, really popular things right now. So, but we need government support in this, definitely.
I'd like to ask you to expand a little more on something you mentioned earlier about Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan being the originators of Lal Bagh as we know it today. So,
so there are it's popularly said that there was already a mango garden that was there, a garden that was there in the area around Lal Bagh, even before Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan. But we do know that from maps, for example, that Hyder set up some gardens initially probably in the Mughal garden format, as they call them, meaning they would be rectangular with channels through them. And Tipu has added to these. Now, we know these for sure because just about a year after Tipu was killed, there was a surveyor who was employed by the East India Company to go through these areas, and he has left like really detailed descriptions about all of these. So we know that the gardens were separate, and that we know that some of them were used to grow experimental things like ragi and rice, and others were growing fruits and flowers, and all kinds of things were happening in these two gardens. So we know that for sure. It is likely that there was a garden even before that.
So can you say a bit? Okay, can you say a bit more about Kabban Park, like what's going to happen to it and what can be done?
If you're talking about the building that is planned to be, that is proposed to be built there, I do not believe it will happen because there has been plenty of opposition to it, and all said and done, people, officials, the government does listen. They do take note of protests. So I'm fairly confident, and I'm hopeful and confident it will not happen. The building will not come up there.